the good news in government? I don't know if some of you, this is a Gartner chart, not a George Newsom chart. If some of you have looked at some of this data, but the government is spending somewhere in the neighborhood of $500 billion U.S. dollars in information technology. This is an interest. Can you see the numbers? Okay, on the slide. Yes. No. Can you see the numbers on that slide? Some of the interesting notions. This is the biggest number right here. It's telecom services. But look at the growth rate of telecom services. Smaller. Look at the growth rate of software. Did you see on my previous slide, software as a service, software is doing everything? What is the cloud? We, the industry, have sold citizens, people, that technology is up there. It's not up there, it's in a box, somewhere. Look at what software is doing. It's software-defined applications, software-defined data centers, software-defined information. That's growing, and that's a chart that's quite interesting. Some of the others are also, and by the way, this is true in most sectors. It may be even truer, I don't know about Brazil. It's very true in the U.S. government sector. We have a tremendous amount of legacy systems that have to be modernized. We'd love to get them all on applications, but you got to get past what I'm describing on this chart first. A lot of money's being spent on operating current systems versus going to new, more productive, innovative systems. This is the world, $500 trillion being spent. This slide kind of depicts the previous one. The right bubbles are the ones that you want to be in. The right bubbles are the ones that companies strive to be in. Not to say, by the way, that you can't stay here. This is not going to go away. The growth rate is smaller for government in these sectors right here. Hardware, software, services. But when you get up here to IT and software, that's where the growth is going to be. Mostly cloud driven. These are all U.S. dollars. I can't, we haven't broken out, or Gartner hasn't broken out by countries as well. Let me spend a few minutes, and this is not a few minute discussion. I've been in government business for 500 years, and I still don't know enough about it. But I want to tell you a little bit about what the world of U.S. federal government business looked like. The previous chart had $500 trillion. The United States spends $200 billion of that $500 trillion. I'll show you a chart in a moment on how that's broken out. We have a very, very open protocol in government work. And Humberto and I and Giovanni spent time at lunch on that too. So does Brazil. Everything is open. There are very, very few dollars that are spent mostly in the, we call it the intelligence community world, which is three letters usually. There's a few dollars that are spent there, but most of it is very open protocols. The government has to put out an RFP, and private sector responds to those RFPs. It is also a very clear purchasing system. I know we have at least one lawyer in the room. I'm going to go to the next slide. I know we have one lawyer in the room. This is called the Federal Acquisitions Regulations. That's the shortened version. It's 1,800 pages long. To be in government business, you must know every word in that book. Now, I don't know any of those words. I also have good lawyers. But you have to know everything, and you must sign that I've done everything in my contract according to that document right there. Federal Acquisition Regulations. That's the desktop version. Back to this slide. There is a clear rule of law. You saw the document, Federal Acquisition Regulations, but everything else is very well documented. You must be in strict compliance to it all. There are advantages to small businesses in the United States. Humberto, I didn't ask you about the Brazil. And we categorize small business into, I think there's eight women-owned, veteran-owned, service-disabled, veteran-owned, hub zone, which is historical, underutilized business zones. Alaskan Native is the highest category in the United States, Alaskan Native, and then there's three others. So there's advantage to having one of those. The next one is the one that some people get really turned off, some companies get really turned off about, and it's small margins. Let me define small margin. One digit. One digit. Okay? So you think about that and say, my gosh, with all that other stuff up there, and I've got to know everything, and I've got to have a bunch of lawyers, why would I want to do that? Well, you saw the first number, which was $500 billion. The United States is $200 billion of that. I take of the $200 billion, about $60 billion. That's pure services. We call them pure play services, and focus on only $60 billion of that amount. And you got to follow all these rules. There are three contract types in the United States government: firm fixed price, time and material, and cost plus. Cost plus is the most risk-free you can get, right? They're going to pay you for your cost, fully audited cost, fully audited, and give you a fee, single digit. Time and material is very close to that. You submit a labor rate, they buy it. You better be right on your labor rate. You better be right in what you did in your dollars in getting there. Firm fixed price, my favorite contracting type, if the buyer knows what they want. Government tends not to know what they want or changes their mind. I wish Tony Scott were here. He is the U.S. CIO. I wish he were here. It's not his fault. It's that things change. Umberto worked in government. Things change every day, every minute, every hour, and you got to change programs and systems. Well, that's okay, except you have a firm fixed price contract for a specific scope of work. Those two clash tremendously. So there's great opportunity for upside margins on firm fixed price. There's equal opportunity for horrible losses if you haven't scoped it correctly, or you allow scope creep in the contracts. But commercial folks generally don't like government margins. They're low, they're lower, I should say. The last one in that book that I showed you, there is an entire section called Cost Accounting Standards, CAS. It tells you how to account for every penny of your contract. Every penny of my contracts are audited. Not randomly, they're all audited. So we have to be very, very careful about what we do, as I'm sure you do too in your government business. So this is the beginnings of a marketplace. It's really good. It's really big. They pay. My government pays. They're not late. Very infrequently are they late in their payments. So if you can get in, it's a very positive situation. This is the U.S. numbers. And it's about, it's 200, just under $200 billion. I focus on the $60 billion, that's in gray. The $80 billion. $80 billion, there's some hardware in there as well. I focus on about $60 billion. Those numbers are almost exactly as you saw in the entire globe. That software is growing, the others are pretty stagnant. They're still gonna grow a little bit, but software is where the rest of the world is growing. This chart has been the same for a number of years. I'm gonna say 3 years. The US government budget hasn't changed much. This hasn't changed much, but it's still a very, very large number. By the way, the chart behind me is only information technology. It's not aircraft carriers, planes, bullets, shoes, right? None of that. It's all stuff that we do in our industry. That's why there, every major U.S. corporation is involved in U.S. government in some fashion or form. You might have thought that I mentioned some barriers to government business in the past. Here are some things that also impact the way we do business. Competition. It's easy to say, I don't want to go into this business because of all the rules, all the regulations. By the way, if you fail or regulation issues, not only can you fail getting business, there's an even worse word in my world. It's called disbarment. Lawyers know that word. If you're disbarred from the bar, you can't practice law. You can get disbarred in government contracting in the United States. It's the worst infliction that you can get, because not only does it impact that contract or that business, it flows over to the commercial world as well, because the competitors in commercial world say, here's what you did over here. But it's a large, large industry. You saw the numbers before. In U.S. government business, they also don't like to issue RFPs and contracts for a specific scope of work. So what they do is they issue something called contract vehicles, government-wide purchasing vehicles. So they will put out a $1 billion contract and ask for SysAd services, data center services, software services, apps mod services. All in one big thing, you put in your bid for each one of those services, and then you wait to be awarded one or more. They usually award 10 to 20 of those contracts for $1 billion. Now they're awarding 50 to 80. So not only you didn't win anything when you won, you got to win the tasks that go after that. That's one of the best and worst things that are going on in government right now. There's a worse one in a second. I already talked about small business goals, set asides. Past performance is really important. You have to show and demonstrate that you've done that type of job before. We fight all the time with government because they like to say, have you done this before in government? Well, what if you did it for Hilton or Marriott or somebody else? Does it count? We fight all the time with our government. Sometimes we win, sometimes we lose. Financial consideration, I've touched on some of those, why you'd want to be in government, why you wouldn't want to be in government business. In addition to that, government tends not to want to use their own capital. So if they have a data center project where you have to stand a data center up, they like industry to use their capital, not theirs. That's okay. If you get a 5 to 6 to 8 to 10 year contract, it's not okay if the contract's for a year, right? Hard to recover, CapEx, in that, you pick the times. So there's additional financial considerations there. The next one is the one that's giving me and my colleagues in the industry the greatest angst. The government would like to buy innovation and creativity. They would like to buy value services, but they're not doing that right now. They're buying something called low price technically acceptable. Tell me what logo that you know that does government business that's not technically acceptable. General Dynamics, Northrop Grumman, Boeing, Accenture, Dell, name one. Therefore, if the buying protocol is low price technically acceptable, if they're all technically acceptable, what's left? Low price. And unfortunately, this pendulum has swung back and forth over decades. What someone will discover is low price technically acceptable in about 3 years from now is not going to be the low price they thought it was, because it doesn't include life cycle costs. It only includes a small portion of that. That's driving some people out of the business. They can't afford to do low-cost, low-price, technically acceptable business anymore. Cost accounting standards, I've already mentioned a couple times. Everything is open. I have to keep a time card. Every hour that I work, I have to charge the government, and I have to keep a time card. Everybody that works for me does the same thing. The next one is U.S.-based delivery. The U.S. government, I don't know about your country, I don't know. In the continental United States, they make exception for Alaska and Hawaii, but in the continental United States, they argue about Puerto Rico. They'll argue whether you can do it in Puerto Rico or not. But you must do it. You cannot avoid that. You cannot subcontract to somebody who you don't know very well that might be doing offshore work. One more time, if you get caught, remember that penalty, in addition to financial disbarment. Foreign-owned control and influence. The U.S. government also worries a lot about intellectual capital leaving the country. So they worry, if a foreign entity goes into a government contract, they want to mitigate control and influence. So there's a specific, and it's actually a congressional specific committee that looks at that and has to approve any of those transactions, any foreign entity buying a U.S. asset. And the last one is the budget constraint. Did you know, today is Sunday, did you know that last Wednesday the U.S. government didn't have a budget? That we were going to go out of business yesterday? Now, that happens every year. Every year. So what our brilliant politicians do, please don't quote me, is they extend last year's budget for another year. We've only done that 4 years in a row. Extend last year's budget for another year. So on Thursday, we extended last year's budget for 2 months and 9 days. Guess why? Absolutely. 2 months and nine, not 1 year, 2 months and 9 days to get past the budget. And then whoever's in there is going to have to figure out what happens next. So in addition to some of the others, look, I believe there's a wonderful opportunity for people, and I'm going to show you the best path for people to get in there. Government is looking for innovation. They're looking for new players. They're looking for people who can do the job differently, better, smarter than others have before. But there are some hurdles that go along with all that. There are companies that have done really well in the United States government. Now, I happen to put six that are large. There are 600 that are not. So they have figured out what it takes to do business in the United States government. There's a German company up there. There's a Canadian company up there. Look at Accenture. They kind of moved. But doing extremely well in the United States government, doing United States government business. So the path, if you're in a company, you have an interest in doing business in the United States. Giovanni, Humberto, you know it here in this wonderful country very, very well. But if you have an interest, then let me show you a path that might get you there. You really can't show up to Washington, D.C. tomorrow and say, I want to go bid on this RFP. It's public, right? It's public. I want to bid on that RFP. What's your references? What's your track record? How many have you done before? Have you mitigated foreign ownership, control, and influence? Have you done all that stuff? So a really good way to do that is team with somebody. Team with a company. Pick Dell. Pick HP. Pick somebody that does government. Get in, get your foot in the door, do some business with them, and then figure out all the other things. The other one is joint ventures, depending on your appetite, on how fast you want to move, how much you want to get into. Look at a joint venture opportunity. There is a slight issue with ownership beyond 50%. Simple to solve, don't do beyond 50%. But a joint venture is another one. Partnerships of multiple kinds, whether they're marketing partnerships, value partnerships, or things like that. And the last one is just look at companies that are there. You have to get past the hurdle that I described, foreign ownership, control, influence, and control and influence. But it is doable. CGI was a Canadian company that bought a U.S. company. So all of these things are doable.